This is the magazine show dedicated to university sports, and in this month's edition we meet five athletes from five countries and five different sports who will be following in the run-up to the 2013 Universiade. In part two we'll meet a legend of university sports, archer Juan Carlos Holgado, and be reflecting on a memorable 2009 winter Universiade in Harbin in China. In part three, we'll have all the latest news from the world of student sports, and tennis champion Lina remembers her hat-trick of medals at home in Beijing 12 years ago. All to come on campus. The 27th Summer Universiade will start on July 6th in Kazan, and we'll gather the best athletes from the world of university sports in 27 different disciplines. We've selected five of them who are rising and promising stars. Over the next few months, we'll be following our campus team. Now let's meet them. First up, an Australian swimmer, David McKeon. David's 20. He's already won a gold medal in the 400-metre freestyle at the Shenzhen Universiade. He also took part in the Olympics last year in London. Big first test for him. He became national champion at 400 metres in 2012 too. He's studying public health at the University of Wollongong. We'll be meeting David Belonga next week. Wojtek Skodlarczyk is from Poland. He's 27 and he plays badminton, the men's doubles and mixed doubles. He won a bronze medal at the World University Championships in 2010 and 2012. He's part of the Polish national team and won the Polish Open last year. He's studying management at the University Adam Mickiewicz in Poznan. Richards is a Jamaican competing in the shot put. He won gold at Shenzhen with a throw of 1993 and became the first Jamaican to win this title. He was born in 1988 and he studies at the famous University of Technology in Jamaica. Ashley Shakir Altekin already boasts an impressive CV. The Turkish 1500 metre runner won the Shenzhen University title in 2011 and then the Euros in 2012. And won the gold at the London Olympics. She studies at the Damlupinar University in Kataya. So each month from now until the Universiade in July, we'll be bringing you all the latest news from these athletes. We'll be getting to know them in turn a little better too. first we meet Wojciech Skodlarczyk. We're going to see him in Poznan, where he's studying management. Famous old university town, this. Wojciech feels at home there.
Hi, we are already on my University of Adam Mickiewicz in Poznan. We are having my courses.
Wojciech is 27. He's been at the University Adam Mickiewicz for 9 years. It's a Sunday morning, but nevertheless, he's heading on campus to the Faculty of Law and Administration.
We are starting my course, just follow me.
Wojciech was born in Warsaw, but his family originates from Poznan. It's a logical step to study here.
I choose the University of Poznan. They give some scholarships that also give us the individual organization of study from first year, so we can arrange our plan by ourselves with professors, so we can pass the exam on different dates. There's no problem with that. So this is opportunity which gives, I think, 3 or 4 universities in Poland.
The University Adam Mickiewicz is one of the leading academies in Poland. It's named after Adam Mickiewicz, a Polish writer who was one of the most important poets in European Romanticism. In Poznan, 1 in every 4 young people is a student. In addition to its historic and modern facilities, it has campuses all over the country.
Adam Mickiewicz is one of the largest universities in Poland. It was founded in 1919, just after we got our independence. And we got quite 50,000 students, almost 3,000 workers, professors and master degrees and PhDs.
And sport is a significant factor in those coming to Poznan to study.
In 2011 we got a second place as the most sports university in Poland. 2012 we got a third place. We have success in sports field. We got over 40 sports sections, so each student can get actually can find something for himself.
UAM is supporting all sports across the board, particularly volleyball, in which they're having some impressive results.
Actually, we got a green light from university authorities for professional teams. We got a volleyball team in the first league. Also, we got a very strong triathlon section. It's quite a big thing for us to be the most sports university in Poland. But actually, we hope to do this next year.
It's a Sunday evening. Wojciech jumps in the car, leaves Poznan for the long drive to Warsaw and the National Training Centre. It's a 300-kilometre drive. Once in the capital, the Polish National Badminton Training Centre is located in the suburbs of Warsaw. It's a completely different background for Wojciech, who's just starting out his life as an athlete.
My week starts on Monday morning, like today we start morning practice, and until Friday we have the practice twice, every time 2 hours, sometimes a bit more. Friday evening we have the last session, and then on Sunday and Saturday we're moving to our university to study. Sometimes we go to play the leagues or any other competitions. So during the season, from August till May or June, we don't have any weekend for free. It's maybe 3 or 4 times we have only weekends for us, for ourselves, for resting and do whatever we want.
Poland is among Europe's best performing nations, alongside Denmark, England and Germany. Badminton is one of the quickest developing sports in Poland. The National Federation has built a strong group of players in Warsaw.
At the moment, we've got in the elite squad 18 players, and this is including singles games and doubles games and mixed doubles games. And also we start to build up the new structure, and we bring the young players into the central camp, and hopefully in the next 2 or 3 months we will have another 10 players, top juniors from the whole country.
Warsaw, Wojtek trains with his doubles teammates Agnieszka Wojtkowska in the mixed doubles and Lukas Morin in the men's.
We play together from 2 years. We play a lot of tournaments. Last season we played around 15 tournaments together, and we are good friends, and we understand each other in the court and also in the life, and it's. I am happy that I play with Wojciech. This season we want to still growing in the world ranking. It's our main achievement. We want to go for first 20 on the world ranking in double.
Currently they're the world number 36 and European number 8. Wojciech won the bronze medal in mixed doubles at the World University Championships in Korea last year. During this tournament, he faced Olympic champions and world-level players from Asia.
The University World Championship, we can see that a lot of top players participate in this tournament. So the fact that he won the medal, that means that he is in the on the top shelf, and he can compete with the best players in the world. So for him, it's a big achievement for us also. And I think Wojtek will be more hungry for the next one, and he will achieve even more.
Yeah, after 2 medals in 2010 and 2012, Wojtek now aims for the Universiade 2013 in Kazan. He knows it'll be a decisive step on the road to the Rio Olympics of 2016.
Universiade is one of the biggest events in the world, I think, even if it's for students and under 20 years, 28 years old. I think it's very big event, and it's looking like normal Olympic Games or venues, and a lot of spectators, very high level, a lot of medalists of Olympic start on Universiade, so it's also big prestige to get a medal there.
Come the Universiade this summer, where does Wojtek want to be?
Now you can imagine when I want to be on the Universiade in Kazan. See you there.
Top spot on the podium. We'll see. Juan Carlos Holgado is a Spanish archer. At just 18, he was granted a scholarship at the residence Joaquin Blume in Madrid and became the first archery athlete in the history of this high-performance sports centre. It allowed him to develop as an athlete with a professional mentality. He's a Bachelor of Physical Education and Sports. I started archery when I was 9. We didn't have any facilities to practice archery in the past, even at the sport university. Today, there have been a lot of changes, a lot of coordination between the university studies and sports training. We improved with the authorities of the university and government the importance of coordinating and creating a system between study and sport and between training and study. And today the situation is much better, so an athlete has time to do both, to study and to practice sport. The atmosphere, the memories of university life, the 12 years I spent at university, all great because it was a happy time in my life. I was happy in my work each day, in my responsibilities as events director. I had the feeling of creating a team, creating an atmosphere of work that was enjoyable and hardworking. In university sport, you have competition, but when you finish this event, you look for relationships to maintain good agreements, good atmosphere, and to meet and learn about other countries. My first memory was the university championship in Spain and my classification. The second was in Belgium, where the result wasn't so good for me, but the team finished third, and that brought me great joy. Barcelona 92 was the greatest moment. It was the greatest experience of my life. Olympic gold champion, Barcelona, the Olympic Games at home. We weren't the favourites, and archery wasn't popular. It's the moment I cherish most. It was all to do with the passion of archery and my professional work. What happened after Barcelona was like a bomb. Archery wasn't a popular sport and benefited a lot from this, as well as Spanish university, who didn't have archery schools. They tried to build some, and there was a big explosion of archery after the success we had in those Olympics. A lot of our athletes, around 30 to 40%, use university competition to prepare for European championships or world championships or even Olympics. FISU accepts that archery is put in a compulsory program. Archery now is fixed in the program, and so we will be in Gwangju in Korea. To have good results in world championships at university level, it's a world high level with maybe up to 60 countries. Good results offer a lot of prestige and a lot of character. This is interesting and important because all athletes like this competition. They're very competitive and always want to win. It's good preparation and training because it's the same rules as the Olympic Games. And the third reason to participate is it's just great fun. And at a high level, you suffer a lot, but get a lot out of it.
In 1994,
combining his training and studies, Juan Carlos created the School of Archery at the University of Madrid. He's able to communicate his archery passion and pass on his knowledge to the current students. He professes himself lucky that his job is also his hobby. The 2009 Winter Universiade took place in Harbin in China. Over 1,500 athletes from 44 countries participated, among them 60 from Switzerland and a man with a famous surname, Kush. That's Dimitri. Didier's distant cousin was involved in two events in the alpine skiing program on the magnificent Dagokoi slope, giant slalom and slalom. And the giant slalom, the second leg was decisive for Dimitri, who surged up from sixth place after run one and to win ahead of Japan's Akoshi and Midol of France. In the slalom, Kush again achieved an incredible second leg. And a second 40 faster than his opponents, he won ahead of Pascolderung of Italy. And once again, Midol. Kush completed a grand slam for Switzerland in the alpine skiing with 5 gold medals. Dimitri participated in the Erzurum Universiade in 2011, but decided to end his career the same year after several back problems. A student from the University of Neuchâtel focused on his law studies, but fantastic memories here from Harbin 2009 and the Winter Universiade. Dimitri Kush, a FISU legend. Well, there's more to come after the break on campus. All the latest news from the world of university sport, and we meet Lina. historic ship Sadov, carrying the Universiade torch, reached Vladivostok last month after covering 45,000 nautical miles around the world. The torch started its odyssey on board the four-masted bark Sadov on July 15th from Brest. Kazan 2013 ambassadors such as ice hockey player Alexei Morozov, tennis player Dinara Safina were there to welcome it. On January 25th, the torch relay began on Russian soil. Travelling from west to east, the flame will be carried through Russia's 30 top student cities, finishing its journey at the football stadium in Kazan on July 6th, on the day of the opening ceremony of the 2013 Summer Universiade. A meeting at FISU headquarters in Lausanne was held on February 2nd in regard to the legacy project initiated by the organising committee of the 2015 Summer Universiade in Guangzhou with the coordination of FISU and WADA, the World Anti-Doping Agency. This legacy programme includes a project to unite the North and South Korean teams at the Universiade, one of the main goals of Guangzhou 2015. Another part of the project is to plan WADA efforts until 2015 with the task of developing anti-doping materials, including an e-textbook that raises social awareness on doping to be used throughout universities. And the organising committee of the Granada 2015 Winter Universiade launched its official volunteer video clip recently. The goal of the campaign is to gather more than 1,000 volunteers to help out in organising these Winter Games. Granada will host the 27th Winter Universiade in 2015. In the same venue next month, Sierra Nevada will host the finals of the FAS Snowboard World Cup. Tissot, famous Swiss watchmaker since 1853, will be the official timekeeper of the next Universiade. The partnership with FISU, a major event, underlines Tissot's commitment to sport and timekeeping. This partnership with FISU is even more important for us because it concerns young people. They're trendsetters. They're at the top of technology. It was an obvious and good choice for Tissot to provide our timekeeping at the Universiade. C'est un bon choix. Tissot is already involved in sport through subsidiary company Swiss Timing. We're the official timekeeper for four cycling world championships. We're also official timekeeper of the fencing world championships, the MotoGP Grand Prix. This know-how that we have through Swiss Timing develops every year with Universiades every 2 years. Swiss Timing is the timekeeping company of the Swatch Group. Tissot is part of the Swatch Group. They provide timing and results on events like the Olympics, skiing world championships, or Roland Garros, the French Open tennis. It's important for a federation like us, which organises multi-sport games, 27 sports for instance in Kazan, to be associated with the biggest timekeeper in the world. We now have two important partnerships. We have a partnership with Eurosport, which will allow us major visibility of our major events. And when you have 80 hours of live transmission like it will be in Kazan, it will be important too to have a partnership with the best timekeepers. Chinese tennis star Li Na, the world number 5, was back in a Grand Slam final again at the Australian Open. She's come a long way since her home Universiade in Beijing back in 2001. Great memories.
Exciting, you know, because I was playing in Beijing, all the fans was come to support. After I was feeling okay, you can play good tennis. I was winning singles, doubles, and mixed. Not bad.
Li Na turned pro in 1999, but also studied at the Kazan University of Science and Technology, where she completed her bachelor's degree in journalism. University was key for her.
You can learn different way, not only think about tennis. You can you can hear another people think about how was the tennis. So like before, I only think, oh, tennis is my whole world, you know. It's only thing about tennis. But after I was coming to university, I meet the friend on the university, and they say, tennis, we are not interested. What's about that? So I was feeling like they are just dropped me down, you know. I was feeling like all of my world is crashed because I never think about that this happened before.
Well, she went on to win Roland Garros in 2011. A real example of how university success can lead to greater glory.
I think give their chance, you know. I mean, if they come to the big, how to say, big tournament or something, they can see the different people. They can learn different as well. You know, they will come same like Olympics. All the athletes stay in the same area for the, I think they call university village or something. So you can see another sport, you can meet another good friend, or you can find the best friend for your life. So I think it was a good experience for all the life.
12 years on from that terrific success, the Universiade still holds a special place in the heart of Lina. That's all for now. Next month, on March 27th, on campus, we'll be in Australia at the University of Wollongong, meeting David McKeon. We'll also be updating you on the progress of our other campus team members and all the rest from the world of university sport. See you next month.